Today we have a Vultr setup tutorial. Now this includes a Vultr WordPress setup tutorial along with a Vultr email setup tutorial. Now we're going to be using the Plesk control panel to do all this. This makes it quite easy. We've got quite a lot to cover, but this makes it very simple, completely graphically based when we use Plesk, and there's no need to use the command line at all if we use this method. And Plesk comes free when you use Vultr. And another reason I love using Vultr is I've got a basic template website set up here, and I'm running this through Google PageSpeed Insights. I'm actually getting 100 on their mobile benchmark here. Now, normally that's pretty difficult to achieve. I have benchmarked Vultr against its competitors in a previous video. I'll put that link up there, but Vultr makes this quite easy to do in comparison with other infrastructure hosts. So I really love recommending this. And also email is working really well as well. Email is going through to Gmail just fine here. So if all this sounds interesting, then keep watching. Now you can follow along this tutorial completely for free if you follow the link in the description. That's going to give you 14 days of free credit to use on Vultr. Follow that link or just head to ids.com.au/Vultr and go ahead and click sign up. Fill in an email, password, I'm not a robot, and create an account. After signing up, you'll get an email with a link. The link will bring you here. You'll notice that you've got $100 of free credit for your first 14 days. There's no need to use any code here. My link automatically gives you that credit. Just fill that out with your name, country, address, card details. Click this box that says, I just want to link my card with a $0 deposit. So it's completely free for your first 14 days. Agree to the terms of service and then go ahead. All right, now that we're all signed up and logged in, we are under products and we are deploying a new instance. So there's lots of options here. I'll just go through what I prefer when I'm setting this up. The best value one I've found is called Cloud Compute here. And there's a few other options for the processor here. From what I've found running WordPress, I think the best database performance comes from Intel's high frequency. It may depend on what app or system you want to run exactly, which one you want to use. But from what I've seen, Intel high frequency is what I like. I may do some more benchmarks to see what the actual difference is here, but I'll go with high frequency Intel today. And choose a location closest to your audience. I think for English speaking audiences, North America is generally the way to go. So I'll go with New York here, but again, choose something that suits yourself. We're going to go with marketplace apps here, and we want to use Plesk. So we select the version here. We need to click on that little gray part there on select version and choose Web Admin SE. That's the free version of Plesk. Now we scroll down, we choose the cheapest one here. Again, you can scale up as you need, but for what we're doing today, the cheapest one is going to work fine. 1 gigabyte of memory and one CPU is okay. We can actually turn off the auto backups. They charge $1.20 per month, but we don't actually need that. Plesk actually has its own backup system that you can use for free, so you don't really need to pay extra for those. And apart from that, we can add a server hostname and label. I'm going to call it Plesk Demo for today, and then we go ahead and hit deploy. So now we can see our Plesk demo server is installing. This will take a minute, so just be patient while this installs. So that took about 30 seconds. We've got server added successfully there. It is running. We can go and see our server details here if we click the server. So we'll get a message saying that it does take a few minutes to finish installing and booting up. So just be patient. Everything might not work straight away. So maybe just come back after a few minutes here. But we have got our IP address, username and password here, and our login address for Plesk. All right, so if we actually visit this, we can open this in a new tab. And we should get an SSL warning trying to access this IP here. I'm using Google Chrome. If we go to advanced here, we can actually find our Plesk page login. And it'll be a randomly generated name. So I'm called Sleepy Villani. So yours will be a little bit different, but we can copy that. We can paste that in here. And this will take us to our Plesk login. So we can go ahead and accept our cookies here. But basically, this Plesk page login is a way of giving us SSL secure login while we set this up. So this is a nice little security feature. Now our username and password are back on our Vultr settings here. So we can grab our password there, and our username is going to be root. So I'll just paste that password in, and username is root. So there we go. We can go ahead and log in. Now we just need to fill this in for our admin details. So contact name, email address, and a password here. This is going to be for our admin username that we can use later. So set that up. You can generate a nice password using the generator there. Tick the confirm and we can enter Plesk. So this takes a few seconds while this sets up, and we can still see it ticking away down there. So just be patient while this finishes up. All right, now in Plesk, we're ready to add a domain. So I've got a domain that I've already bought from Namecheap. It's called ideaspot.xyz. What I'm going to do is point this domain over to our Vultr IP address. So this is our Vultr IP address that we talked about earlier. I'll just copy that one. And in Namecheap, I'm going to use the DNS manager to point my domain over to that IP address. So I'm using Namecheap here, but GoDaddy, Google Domains, whatever, it's quite a similar process. We just need to add some records here. I do have some default records here that when I bought the domain that I can go ahead and delete. If you've got old records that you don't need anymore, go ahead and delete them. We're gonna add some new records into our DNS. So the first one is the A record for the root, that's at the IP address. We paste in the IP address, that looks all good. And we're gonna repeat this, we're gonna do a CNAME record. And that is www, and that's going to be ideaspot.xyz in there. We're going to click the tick there. And I'm going to add a few more A records for some subdomains that we're going to use for the tutorial. So I'm going to use a mail subdomain there. So I'm going to put mail A record. I'm going to do another A record for webmail. So webmail at the IP address. And the other thing I want to do is have a custom panel domain name. So I'm going to access my panel on Plesk at ideaspot.xyz. So we'll make one called Plesk and add that in there as well. So I've got the root, and I've got mail, webmail, and Plesk all pointing to the IP address, and I've got my CNAME www pointing to my root domain there. So that is all you need to get started. Again, it doesn't matter if you're not using Namecheap, just wherever you've bought your domain, you can probably set up a DNS record that looks like that. Now, at this point, I think it's worth checking our DNS propagation to see if our DNS is pointing to our IP, just to be sure here. So I'm going to go for ideaspot.xyz, and let's go search. And we should be seeing it hit our IP address across the world here. So that looks pretty good. So as long as this is working, we're ready to go on to our next step here. We can add our domain to Plesk. So here, I'm just going to add our domain. That is ideaspot.xyz. In this case, we're going to add the domain. There it goes. That should be ready in just a second. That page will automatically refresh, and here we are on our main page. Now, the first thing I'd like to do is actually change our Plesk page URL to a custom URL. So let's head over to our tools and settings here, and we can go to server settings. So here is where we can change our host name to a custom host name. But before I do that, I'd like to add an SSL certificate to our actual custom host name that we're going to use. So we're going to go to tools and settings here, and we'll go to it's SSL and TLS certificates. There we go. And all we do here is add a let's encrypt certificate, and rather than using the Plesk page, we're going to use Plesk at ideaspot.xyz. So whatever you've chosen in here, we're going to use that as our domain name to access Plesk. So and we can change this email address as well. So once you've got your email and your domain name in there, let's hit renew, and that will issue a certificate for our subdomain here. So that looks all good. We have got the new certificate set up here. So we can basically head over to Plesk ideaspot.xyz now. From here you go Plesk ideaspot.xyz and colon 8443, and this is going to get us to our panel. So now we can access our panel through Plesk ideaspot.xyz on port 8443. We can log in with those admin credentials that we set up earlier. So I'll just punch those in. So there's our admin username and password that we set up earlier, and we can log in. Great. So we do have a warning there saying someone else is logged in as admin. So that is just under our old URL. If we were just refresh the page, that should go away. That looks all good. And I think now we can go under tools and settings. And if we go to our server settings, we should be able to actually change our full host name to match our new host name that we're using here. So let's punch that in there. I'll delete out the old one. And we don't need HTTP, just Plesk ideaspot.xyz. Looks all good. We can hit OK. And there we go. So our new server setting is Plesk ideaspot.xyz. So by changing that setting, we can actually access the panel without using that port number now. So if we just go straight to Plesk ideaspot.xyz, we should be able to get to our panel. There we go. Probably the next step that we'd want to do is secure this website domain with SSL as well. So let's head over to our SSL and TLS here. And there's a few options down the bottom here. So we can use a free Let's Encrypt certificate. We can upload a custom certificate, or we can go in here and manually paste certificates in as well. So for this demo, let's use Let's Encrypt. Click Install here. email address is already there. We want to secure the domain name. Let's also secure our www, our webmail, and our IMAP POP and SMTP. Now we'll click get it free. Now this should automatically generate our certificates. This does take a little while, so be patient here. And we get our green tick message there. That's all been successful. Now we can add a few extra security settings here, but we'll do that later in the tutorial. What I want to do right now is look at adding some applications. Like you can head over here and you can see we've got the WordPress, Joomla, or Drupal. You can also access WordPress through WordPress on the menu there as well. And you can add a WordPress site to our domain. So if I click install WordPress, we can then go ahead and fill this stuff out. So basically you want to leave that installation path blank there, give it a website title, but you can change that later, obviously. Username, strong password there. You can generate passwords with that button as well. So that looks all good. The rest of this can be default if you like and install. So this will take a little bit to install here. So just be patient there. It'll ask us if we want to add plugins now, but we can obviously add plugins through the WordPress dashboard. So I'm going to click no thanks there. So that looks all good. We've got a WordPress website here. We can actually open that website. Let's do it in a new tab. There we go. And if we add /wp-admin to our address there, so wp/admin, we can get to our panel. We can log in with the credentials that we set up earlier. There we go. And there we go. We're in WordPress dashboard. We've got SSL. This is all ready to go. We can go to appearance and themes. We can start building a site. We can go install a migration plugin like all-in-one migration or duplicator and bring in an existing WordPress website. So I've done that on the channel before if you want to check those videos out. But let's head back to Plesk and let's see what else we can do here. All right. While we're here, it's worth turning on caching with Nginx. That gives us a little bit of an performance boost under load. So caching is enabled. We've got that success message here. The next thing we might want to do is head over to mail. Now we can start setting up mail. So let's head to the mail settings here. And we've got Ideaspot XYZ is already there. Let's have a look at the settings here. We do want to use DKIM spam protection. So that one is off by default. We definitely want to tick that one and click apply. So that looks all good. So we're going to have to put our mail settings into our DNS now. So the next step to do that, we basically go back to websites and domains. We're going to find our domain here, hosting and DNS. Let's look at our DNS settings. So we'll need to add a few more records to our Namecheap DNS here. So the first one is our text, our SPF record here. So let's grab that one there and back to Namecheap in our DNS manager here. We're going to add a record here and this is going to be text. It's going to be on the root. And that's our SPF record there. And the next one is going to be DMARC. So that's underscore DMARC. And we're going to add that one as a text as well. So we've got underscore DMARC and the value here. Put that in. It's all good. What's our next one? And our default domain key. That is also text. Text, default domain key, and the value is all this good stuff. So just make sure we highlight all this here. Hopefully we've copied this properly. That looks okay. Let's paste it in there. That looks okay. Click the tick. Okay. And what other records do we need for mail? We just need domain key, underscore domain key. There we go. Add that text in. And the value is just that little bit of info there. Cool. All right. So there's just one last record to add. That is the MX record down the bottom there. So mail, Ideaspot XYZ. That is an MX record and that's pointed to the root there. So we go back to Namecheap now. On some places you can just add MX records in, same as text or A records, but on Namecheap, it's a little bit different. There is mail setting down there. You have to find custom MX. So that's a little bit tricky to find, but at for root here. And the mail server is mail Ideaspot XYZ. Priority will be 10 there. And we save that in. So as soon as that's saved in, we'll be ready to go back to our Plesk panel and we can start adding an email address. So that looks all good. Let's go. All right. So we go back to mail here. And we're going to create an email address. We just need to fill this out. So this is just a name for your email address there. An external address if you need to recover your password and a nice strong password. The rest of this is default. We can click OK. And there we go. We can actually access our webmail through that little icon there if we want to. Or we can just do webmail.ideaspot.xyz. That should forward us to our email client there. We can log in with those credentials that we just used. So this is the full email address as your username and your password. Go ahead and log in. Here we go. Looks all good. So let's just try a test message, make sure this is all working properly so we can compose here. I've got a test message set up. I'll send this over to Gmail. So that's a test message. Let's send this across and see how it works. So that looks like it's been sent. I've got something in our inbox, so that was very quick. Let's have a look here. So this looks fine. Let's have a look at the original here. We just want to make sure that our SPF is passing, DKIM is passing, and DMARC is passing. Now, if the SPF doesn't pass straight away, just give it 15 minutes, half an hour, because mine didn't pass straight away. It just makes sure that all those DNS records have actually propagated across to all these mail servers. So that looks all good. But yeah, just be patient if you don't get the SPF straight away. While we're talking about email deliverability, one thing you should do that will really improve things is in your actual Vultr settings here. So you go to settings in your server, settings in Vultr, there's reverse DNS. So by default, you'll have something like this on vultr.com. You can actually change that to your own domain there. And this will allow reverse DNS lookups. So that's going to improve deliverability. Less emails will end up in spam if you do that as well. So make sure you follow this step. I notice particularly delivering to Microsoft Outlook boxes, this really improves the situation when you do this. One more little tip, if you do run into any issues with your email not sending, not getting through, sometimes port 25 hasn't been set up properly, so you can go through the support, open a general support ticket, and just ask for port 25, just say you want to use a personal email box or you want WordPress notifications, and just estimate how many emails per day roughly you'd be sending through that. I didn't have that issue myself, but some people have raised it, and it's pretty easy to fix that through just raising a support ticket. I think it might depend on what region you're from, if port 25 is set up or not, but like I said, I didn't have that issue, but if you do, it's pretty simple to get that resolved. Alternatively, I usually do say that it's better to host your email externally. So I do have some free methods on the channel. So free Gmail with a custom domain, I can set that up using that tutorial on the channel, and using Zoho, similar as well. Both of those are much easier, and you'll get more reliability and more actually better deliverability when you use a professional email service rather than trying to host your own email server. So check those out as an alternative too. So let's talk about some other features before we wrap this up. From the Plesk panel here, we can have a look at this thing. It's called the advisor. So that little icon there, this little owl thing. Now this is basically trying to upsell extra features on Plesk, but the one we can install is the Plesk firewall. That's free. We can click that one. That'll bring us here. We can go to Plesk extensions and we can turn Plesk firewall on. That's all good. Let's continue. So we'll get a little bit of install progress here and just wait for that to finish. Click OK. So now if we head back to our panel under tools and settings, we'll have a new option under security called firewall. We can see that it's already turned on and all the default rules are turned on as well. So this looks pretty good. What else can we do here? From our panel, there's a few things worth pointing out. We've actually got our mod security and our DDoS protection turned on already, so you don't have to worry about any of those. There are links to our backup and restore and virus scanner here as well, Immunify AV. Those are included for free as well. There are updates you can run from here, but I'll actually show you there's automatic updates set up automatically here as anyway. So under tools and settings, under update settings down here, you can see that under settings, we've got automatic Plesk updates, automatic third-party component updates, and automatic system package updates. So you don't really have to worry about any of those updates if you leave those automatic updates on. Finally, on our domain, there was a few things we could actually turn on, a few features on our security there. So under SSL certificates, under here, there was a few things we could turn on. So we can turn on HSTS, enable those. We can keep websites secured. We can OCSP stapling, turn that one on. And we can also turn the TLS versions and ciphers by Mozilla. We can turn that on as well. So enable that one. And recommended using the intermediate setting there. So just let that turn on. And that looks all good. So that pretty much wraps it up. If we go back to our Plesk panel here, we can add additional websites if we like, just following the same process again. On the free version of Plesk, as we're using, we can have up to three domains on our server, and we can add as many subdomains as we like as well. So that's pretty nice. It's good for running a small server. If you are getting started with running a VPS by yourself, say if you're moving over from managed hosting or something like Cloudways or something like SiteGround, I really think using Plesk is the smoothest transition to experiencing running your own server. So I really enjoy setting up Plesk, especially introducing this to people who haven't tried running a VPS before. So let me know what you think in the comments. Hopefully you've got your own server up and running and everything's running smooth. But anyway, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.